I'm Dr. Keon West of the Institute of Psychological Sciences at the University of Leeds. I'm going to talk today about explanations of prejudice. To talk about explanations of prejudice, I first have to talk a bit about what prejudice is. After that, I'll talk about realistic conflict theory, mostly to get it out of the way, because I don't think that's what we're talking about when we talk about prejudice, at least not in the layman's sense. Then I'll talk about four different theories, psychological theories, of why people are prejudiced that have nothing to do with realistic conflict. So, to begin, what is prejudice? It seems like a very simple concept, but prejudice is actually a bit hairy to define. Everyone agrees that prejudice involves differential group treatment. Work by other psychologists proposes that prejudice should be unfair as opposed to fair, although work by Chris Kandel helps us understand that maybe fair and unfair are again concepts that we're mixing up with the idea of what is prejudice and what isn't. It's very complicated, so I won't go into it too much, but for now we'll accept that it's in some way unfair or unreasonable, not just based on actual things that are going on. And this will become important a bit later on my other slide. And finally, psychologists like Beverly Daniel Tatum say that it's not just unfair, but it has to do with power relationships. So if you don't like a group of people, but they have all the power over you, that's still not prejudice, because no one cares what you think. Only if someone cares what you think does it actually count as prejudice. You don't have to agree with all of this, but try to understand it as a framework for what I'll be talking about later when we talk about why we have prejudices. So the first thing I'll talk about, just to get it out of the way, is realistic conflict. And this is exactly what it sounds like. Conflict between groups for resources that they really need. Resources, however, don't need to be concrete resources. They can be abstract resources. So you can have competition over who gets to be the more popular group, or who gets to be the ones in charge. They don't have to be physical things like food. And in fact, some people argue that these resources can be real or imagined. So it doesn't matter if there isn't any actual competition over actual food. If people think there's competition over food, that's enough to count it as realistic conflict. To represent that in a picture, you'll see that I have on one side blue circles and on the other side green circles. And in the middle, appearing there, are the tasty little resources, food or money or whatever it is, that they want to have. But there's not enough for both. There's only enough for one group or the other group. So that might make one group respond by attacking the other group or demonstrating intergroup bias, doing unpleasant things to the other group, so that the resources are then left for them, and suddenly there's enough for everybody. That's realistic conflict, but it's not what we're going to talk about. What we'll be talking about is psychological reasons for prejudice, even when there isn't any realistic conflict, or at least that's not dependent on realistic conflict. The first psychological theory I'll talk about will be terror management theory. Terror management theory is a bit of a funny name, but it basically means that we are prejudiced in order to escape mortality. What does that mean? Well, terror management takes into account the fact that people have a need for self-preservation. But this need for self-preservation is frustrated by our knowledge of our own impending death. And this frightens us. To cope with this, people can adopt a worldview that offers them either a symbolic or a literal form of immortality. What does that mean? A symbolic form of immortality means that you attach yourself to something bigger than yourself. So you could say, I might be short-lived, but this thing that I'm attached to is bigger than I am, and it's immortal. So if you're a soldier and you're fighting for England, you might say, I would die in this war, but there would be some corner of the world that would be forever England, as said in a famous poem. In that way, you become immortal through your belonging to a group. There are other worldviews that offer you literal immortality. At least, that's what they claim to offer you. So if you're a Buddhist, for example, your body might die, but your soul is immortal, and you will be reincarnated over and over again. And in that way, you never truly die. And many other religions have afterlives or other ways of coping with the human mortality. Where does a prejudice come in? Prejudice comes in through groups that seem to undermine the group that you belong to, or the worldview that you hold. This doesn't have to be deliberate, but if any group poses an alternate worldview, or an alternate cultural frame, then this gives you some psychological discomfort. So if you are proud of England, but you're afraid that France is going to slowly deride England until it no longer exists, you might not like the French. Or if you're a Buddhist and you bump into a group of Christians who say, reincarnation isn't real, but there's this other afterlife that you won't have access to, this might make you uncomfortable. To represent that as a picture, you'll then see these blue circles on one side and the green circles on the other side, and in creeps the scary figure of death, who makes them feel really afraid. At this point, they treat the other group badly to get rid of them, or to at least treat them as though their worldview isn't legitimate. And by doing that, they make themselves feel better. Is there evidence to support terror management theory? Well, yes, there is some. The evidence shows that if you make people more aware of their own mortality, or if you make death more salient, people respond with more prejudice towards outgroups. That's fine. But other people criticize terror management theory, saying that it's hard to distinguish between threats to mortality and just threats. And if you threaten people, they're going to be less pleasant to other people. And this has been a problem for terror management theory. I won't go into it in depth, but I've attached some papers that talk about whether or not this works. The second psychological theory I'll talk about is subjective uncertainty reduction theory. And this is basically using prejudice to escape uncertainty. This theory says that human beings have a need to feel certain about things, or at least they like to avoid feeling uncertain about things, particularly important things. To get around this uncertainty, we attach ourselves to groups, and these groups give us clear behavioral prescriptions so that we know what to do and we know how to handle life. That works well, but the prejudice comes in when other groups have other behavioral norms or other prescriptions, and they challenge what we feel is our certainty about the prescriptions that we have. To represent that as a picture, it's almost exactly the same as terror management theory, except instead of death creeping in, it's a big question mark, uncertainty about life or the future or what we're supposed to do or what our purpose is. And we only get that certainty from our group, but then the other group challenges it, so they have to be gotten rid of. Once the other group is gone, or at least properly denigrated to a point where we no longer feel challenged by them, then we feel a bit better about ourselves, and these questions disappear. Is there evidence for subjective uncertainty reduction theory? Yes, there is. Research has shown that manipulating levels of certainty through practice trials, for example, if you have to do a particular activity, actually reduces or increases the amount of intergroup bias that you demonstrate. That works well, but then it has kind of the same problem as terror management theory, in that some people who criticize these manipulations say that they're probably manipulating more than just certainty. They're manipulating all kinds of feelings, and that these feelings, including self-esteem feelings, which becomes really important a bit later, may be what's actually causing the effect. Again, I won't go into detail, but I have attached a paper that you can read if you'd like to follow up on this more. The third theory is more popular than either of the first two, and this is social dominance theory. Social dominance theory states something else, that human beings have a need for social dominance, but this itself is broken up into two ideas. One is a need for hierarchy, which means that you need to have groups ordered in terms of someone on the top, someone on the bottom. So you need men on the top or women on the bottom, or women on the top, men on the bottom, you don't care, but you have to have some kind of hierarchy. The second part of social dominance is a need for your group to be on the top. So specifically, within this hierarchy, you want your group to be higher up than other groups. And this need for hierarchy and for dominance is what drives prejudice. If I were to represent that as a picture, you'll see the blue and the greens together underneath this red line. They are of equal status. But you see the social dominance desire flashing within the blue dots, and this makes them want to congregate upwards so that they're now above the green dots. There's now a hierarchy, and they are now on top. That's how social dominance theory works. Is there evidence for social dominance theory? Yes, there is. People have found that social dominance orientation, which is measured and only marginally correlates with other things like authoritarianism, it predicts many kinds of prejudice like sexism, racism, chauvinism, patriotism, if you understand that as a prejudice. And so there is some real reason to believe that social dominance orientation will predict prejudiced behavior. The problems with social dominance orientation, however, come a bit earlier. They come in the theoretical construct of social dominance orientation. While it's easy to understand that people are afraid of death, or that people would like to avoid uncertainty, it's a bit less clear that everyone has this universal need for some dominance or some hierarchy, and then to be on top. There are other problems with social dominance orientation as well. The problems come in when you measure the social dominance orientation of low status groups. With high status groups, it works perfectly well. The more social dominance orientation they have, the more they want to support these hierarchies, the more they want to support prejudice. That kind of makes sense. But why would a low status group have high social dominance orientation? And what do you expect when that happens? And this is when the studies get a bit odd. With low status groups, if they support more social dominance orientation, then they actually have less in-group favoritism, which is weird. That's not supposed to happen. And this is explained in one of many ways, such as they're trying to fight against the system to gain higher status, but it does put a really big hole in what social dominance orientation is supposed to represent. These have been handled with various responses, but this is a basic idea of what the criticisms are of social dominance orientation. The last psychological theory I'm going to talk about is social identity theory. And I've left this one till the last place for a reason, because social identity theory is the largest, the most popular, and the most widely supported of psychological theories. So what does social identity theory say? It says that we have social identities as well as personal identities. You may think of yourself as an individual. You may give yourself a name, you have a birthplace, you have an idea of yourself, but you also have an identity that's rooted in the groups you belong to. You may think of yourself as a student of a particular school, or of a member of a particular group, or of a citizen of a particular country, and that this gives you esteem, just like your self-identity gives you esteem. This also means that you don't like your social identity to be threatened. You would like your social group to be on top, and you'd like to think favorably of your social group. And just as in interpersonal things, if your social identity feels threatened, or if you feel like you're feeling a bit low in your social identity, then you try to bolster that. And it's bolstering it that drives that prejudice. It's trying to make your group feel a bit better than other groups, or seem like a nicer group, or a more popular group, or a more powerful group than other groups. The other thing that social identity theory predicts is that if anyone challenges your particular social status, then you're supposed to respond with prejudice. So it works both ways. You use prejudice to build up your self-esteem, and if anyone challenges your self-esteem, they get prejudice in return. What would that look like as a picture? Now you see the blue dots and the green dots congregated together, but they're still individuals. Social identity theory states that they think of themselves as a group. So now you see the blues encased in a circle of blue and the greens encased in a circle of green. And they think blue is good. It's good to be blue. Green is bad, or at least not as good as blue, because we are not green, and it's better for us to be better than for them to be better. If any challenges come up, so if the greens begin to suggest that they are better than or equal to the blues, then the blues respond with prejudice. That either destroys the greens or at least puts them in a position where it's clear to the blues again that it's better to be a blue than a green. As I said before, social identity theory is the most widely used and most popular and best supported of the psychological theories that explain prejudice. So there's actually an incredible amount of evidence for it. And this includes extensive narrative reviews and meta-analyses, which is where you take several studies and you pile them on top of each other and you analyze the data at once and you see what the data says. And these reviews and meta-analyses show that yes, social identity theory is widely supported. In particular, they support the first premise, which is that acting in a prejudiced way or displaying intergroup bias increases your social identity self-esteem. It makes you feel better about yourself through making you feel better about your group. Social identity theory runs into a little bit of a problem with the second premise. It's that people have a harder time finding evidence that if you make people feel bad, they respond with prejudice. It's not that no studies have ever done it, it's just a lot less well supported than the other one. This might be because of the way people have constructed their studies, however, and it might be because of the way people are testing it. They're not actually testing it very well. For a good review of that, again, I've attached a paper for you to look at. That's a general idea of what social identity theory is and how it explains prejudice. None of these theories are supposed to operate entirely by themselves, and they all learn from each other and bounce off each other and grow on each other. And to get a good understanding of why people behave in prejudiced ways, even when there's nothing really to gain from doing that, at least nothing physical, then you should look at all of them and you should try to understand all of them. But for now, that's a good overview of the current psychological theories on why we're prejudiced. And with that, I'm Dr. Keon West of the Institute of Psychological Sciences at the University of Leeds, talking about explanations for prejudice. Thanks very much.